Hello, welcome to my channel Medicine with Dr. Moran. If you've not been here before, my name's Dr. Keith Moran. Do masks really help? You have been told they are for COVID-19, but there actually is very little good quality evidence surrounding masking in the general population. Today I want to talk about a randomized clinical trial that looks at masking and COVID-19. This is a very important study because it truly gets at whether masks are effective with this illness and what type of mask is best. Most people who wear masks use a cloth mask. People were told that this is helpful, but we don't have medical evidence to support this. This type of trial ideally should have been done much earlier in the pandemic. This is the study I want to talk about. The study protocol was reviewed and approved at Yale University and by the Bangladesh Medical Research Council. The funding of the study was a grant from GiveWell.org, a California nonprofit. They had no role in the study design, interpretation of results, or decision to publish. This study has not yet been peer-reviewed. It is a preprint currently. The study's well done and it is overdue. The study was what we call a cluster randomized trial in rural Bangladesh from November 2020 to April 2021. The predominant variant circulating at the time was the Alpha or the UK variant. There was very little immunity in this population. It was done earlier in the pandemic and there were no vaccinations being given. They looked at 600 villages involved with a total number of people 342,126 adults. There were three groups. There was a control group that did not receive any interventions. There was a group that were randomized to surgical masks, and a third group that were randomized to cloth masks. All of the villages in one area would belong to one of the groups so that there would not be a lot of intermingling of people from one group to another. These were the masks used. The cloth mask had three layers, an external exterior layer of 100% non-woven polypropylene and two interior layers of cotton polyester knit with a nose bridge. The surgical mask had three layers of 100% non-woven polypropylene with a nose bridge. The filtration efficiency was 37% for the cloth masks and 95% for the surgical masks. This actually was measured using a particle counter to see what percentage of particles on the order of 0.3 to 0.5 microns would come through the mask at a velocity of 8.5 centimeters per second. The size of the virus for comparison is smaller at 0.1 microns. Now N95 masks will filter 99.8% of particles, 0.1 microns. In the villages who wore masks, masks were distributed at markets or mosques. Mask wearing was promoted in public spaces. There was role modeling and advocacy by local leaders, including imams discussing the importance of mask wearing at Friday prayers. Now for the results. First, physical distancing was assessed. In the control villages, 24.1% practiced physical distancing compared to 29.2% in the villages that used cloth or surgical mask, which was an increase of 5.1%. The increase in physical distancing was similar in the cloth versus surgical masks at 4.4% versus 5.4%, which was not statistically different. So in this study, mask wearing and physical distancing complements rather than substitutes. This is contrary to concerns that mask wearing might promote risk compensation and less physical distancing, but this was not seen in the study. In all of the groups, numerous observations were taken. In the control group, 13.3% of people wore masks properly. In the treatment villages, where they used either cloth or surgical masks, 42.3% of people wore their masks properly. This tripling of mask usage was sustained during the 8-week intervention and for a couple of weeks afterwards. So even in the groups of villages where there was masking, the masking rate was not 100%, but only 42.3%. Physical distancing increased, as I mentioned, from 24.1% in the control villages up to 29.2% in the villages that were masked. There were 335,382 participants who completed the symptom survey. 27,166, which is 8.1%, reported experiencing a COVID-like illness during the study. This was 13,893, or 8.6%, in the control villages versus 13,273, or 7.6%, in the intervention villages. 40% of symptomatic participants agreed to blood collection. They were then tested for IgG antibodies to SARS-CoV-2. This slide shows the data. They found that people with symptoms and positive antibodies were noted in 0.76% of control villages and 0.69% in the intervention villages. These numbers do omit the number of people who didn't consent for blood tests. So the true rate of people with symptoms and antibodies probably would have been 2.5 times higher, assuming the non-consenter had similar likelihood of a positive test. This slide shows the intervention effect. Here you can see that in the control group listed as comparison villages, 0.76% of the total number of people had symptoms and positive antibodies. Now in the cloth mask villages, this was 0.74%, which is a very, very small reduction, which was not statistically significant. In contrast, in the surgical mask villages, there was a reduction of 11.2% down to a level of 0.67%, which did achieve statistical significance. The p-value, as we say, is 0.043, which means that the likelihood of this occurring by chance was 4.3%. And the probability that this is real would be the opposite, which is 95.7%. They point out that this reduction could have been more if more people wore masks, as only 42% in the masking groups actually wore the masks properly. This, of course, is speculation. That might be the case or it might not be. It's also important to note that after 5 months, the impact of masking did wane, but it did remain higher than the control group, about 10% higher. It was in the low 20s, down from the 42%. Thus, the intervention was not sustained, even though it was helpful. I think what the study definitely shows is that surgical masks are better than cloth masks, as one might expect. This study showed that cloth masks actually weren't very helpful. The study also demonstrated that doing a study in the middle of a pandemic is possible. This study shows that we desperately need other randomized trials with masks to tease out who actually benefits from masking. This likely does not have an all yes answer, meaning that everyone should mask. There may be an age above where masking is helpful. For example, do young children in daycare benefit from masking? We don't know the answer to that because we have no trials, and of course, there are significant downsides to masking young children. The age where the WHO recommends mask be worn is different from what the CDC in America recommend. In the UK, kids below 12 were never mandated to wear masks, I understand. Kids, of course, typically wear cloth masks, and this study from Bangladesh showed that the cloth masks in adults did not work. So they probably may not in young kids as well. Now, would surgical masks work in this population? Again, we don't know. You also have the question about whether it's even worth masking children who have such a low infection fatality rate. The infection fatality rate is the odds of dying if they get infected, and for kids it's on the order of 1 in 120,000. Many young children have already had the virus and have developed immunity, although this obviously varies from place to place. The higher the immunity, the tougher it would be for the vaccine to have an impact. Now, what about university students with vaccination rates of close to 100%? In many parts of the world with high vaccination rates, the risk reduction using masks will certainly be smaller because we know vaccinated people transmit less than unvaccinated people. So the question is, how beneficial are surgical masks in highly immune populations? What about scenarios where the community prevalence is low? These obviously require other studies. I think the bottom line from this study is that when you need to wear a mask, you should wear a surgical mask, not a cloth mask. If someone is at very high risk, such as an immunocompromised person, an N95 would be expected to be even better. Thank you for watching today on Medicine with Dr. Moran. I'm Dr. Keith Moran. Get healthy and stay healthy.